Em nome do SEBRAP, eu dou as boas-vindas a todo mundo. É um prazer sem tamanho poder encontrar todo mundo ao vivo. Nessa mesma sala, nós recebemos a notícia do Ministério da Educação e da Pesquisa da Alemanha de que o nosso projeto tinha sido aprovado e que o nosso centro ia ser criado. E é nesta sala que a gente dá início à fase presencial do Messila. Então, nós começamos o Messila em 2017, numa fase preparatória, preliminar. Depois começamos, após essa aprovação em 2019, nós começamos a fase principal. No entanto, com a chegada da pandemia, nós tivemos as duas primeiras turmas de fellows interagindo de maneira remota, digital. Então, para nós, receber presencialmente todo mundo aqui é um sonho que a gente realiza neste momento, né? Então, em nome das sete instituições que compõem o Messila, em quatro países diferentes, eu agradeço a presença de todo mundo. Agradeço a presença dos diretores, dos novos diretores, Peter Schulz e Samuel Barbosa. Agradeço não só a presença da grande diretora Suzane Klengel, mas também da conferencista Suzane Klengel, que vai dar a honra para a gente de dar o início dessa fase presencial. Eu acho que provavelmente eu deveria ter falado em inglês. Mas espero que tenha sido possível para todo mundo entender. E a gente vai fazendo como a gente faz no Messila. Às vezes a gente fala português, a gente fala inglês, a gente fala espanhol, portunhol. A maior parte do tempo a gente tenta falar inglês, mas nem sempre a palavra é a palavra certa. Então a gente vai criando uma língua própria, que nós poderíamos chamar, não é, Suzane, de Messilês. De Messilan. El Messilano, não sei. Algo assim, não? Muito obrigado. Todo mundo seja muito bem-vindo. Que vocês sejam muito felizes nessa estadia aqui em São Paulo, no SEBRAP e na USP, na Universidade de São Paulo. Então, passo a palavra à nossa conferencista, já agradecendo por, além de ter feito tudo o que ela fez como diretora, ainda aceitar ser a conferencista de abertura. Muito obrigado, Suzane.
I think it was completely good, correct to do this and to do the first words here in Portuguese. I thank you very much for your introductory words. I'm extremely happy to be here today and to give my talk on Maria Sibylla Merian in the presence of all of you, of our fellows from 2022, our colleagues from Messila, from SEBRAP, from USP, the members of our staff from the Messila office here in São Paulo, and of course, our member of the advisory board, Jeffrey Lesser, and all our guests from USP, from FCR Law, from the FU Liaison Office, and other persons. I hope I didn't really forget anybody. I think we are all very conscious that this event is truly special. Not because I'm speaking here, but because we can finally meet again in person on this occasion here in SEBRAP. After nearly 2 years of isolation, of physical contact ban, and of exclusively digital communication. Messila worked, as you know, worked well during 2 years, but really just on the digital mode. This is quite amazing, but we still exist, and we exist well, and we are starting now in our presence mode. So this is a real feeling of happiness, I must say, for me, and I'm very, very grateful for this. I'm also grateful to our Mesila office, especially Melanie, who prepared this event so carefully, and to Sebrap for their constant help and for the beautiful setting. And I would also like to take this opportunity to thank our funders, the German Federal Ministry of Education and Research, and our Brazilian partner organizations, Sebrap, EAUSPI. And my thanks again go to all of you who have joined us this afternoon here in person. And at this point, I would like to extend once again a very warm welcome to our fellows who have arrived here in São Paulo in the last few days and weeks, and who will start now to develop their activities and their exciting research projects in our center. So, why Maria Sibylla Merian lecture here and now? For some, this is an obvious choice of topic, but for others, it is not. After all, I will wait until persons can be seated. Yeah, or please have a seat here. Yeah. So for why a Maria Sibylla Merian lecture here and now? For some, this is an obvious choice of topic, but for others, it is not. After all, Maria Sibylla Merian is not necessarily a global known reference. Yet, our 5 centers for advanced studies in India, Ghana, Tunisia, Mexico, and here in Brazil bear this name, Maria Sibylla Merian Center for Advanced Studies in the Humanities and the Social Sciences. The name was chosen for this project several years ago by the German ministry. At this time, the commemoration of the 300th memory of Maria Sibylla Merian's death in 2017 was approaching. I think from a closer look that this is indeed an interesting, even fortunate choice of a name. A choice that arouses curiosity about the person behind it and prompts reflection in many ways. It is about a historically relatively well-known and at the same time marginalized female scientist between the disciplines, within the historical context of the first globalization, including all its concomitants such as European wars, colonialism, and slavery. It is about the relationship between science and art, about the views on phenomena of nature in its smallest dimensions and life cycles, the world of insects, but also about the concrete circumstances of a successful career of a female researcher and artist in the Baroque era, and so on. The journey to Suriname from 1699 to 1701 and the spectacular publication of her book Metamorphosis Insectorum Surinamensium on tropical plants and insects in 1705, which are generally regarded as the most significant events in Maria Sibylla Merian's life, have a lot to do with our research concerning conviviality connected with inequality, which we are thinking of and exploring essentially from the perspective of the Global South. Therefore, what interests me here most about Maria Sibylla's life and work is the continuing impact of these exotic experiences that can be found in the literary and historiographical texts about Maria's life today, the exotic experiences she made in Suriname. My lecture will be structured as follows. I will give you some life data of Maria Sibylla Merian in order to know her and her circumstances, then second, some reflections of biographical writing and some examples from my text corpus, some first examples of my text corpus. The third point will be a detailed and comparative focus on the 6 texts I have chosen with a special emphasis on the Suriname period. And finally, I will make some reflections on biographical representation to conclude my lecture. So first, and very briefly, the key dates in Maria Sibylla Merian's life. Maria Sibylla Merian was born in Frankfurt in 1647. Her family includes well-known artists and publishers. She is the daughter of the famous engraver and publisher Matthäus Merian. Her grandfather is none other than the engraver and publisher Johann Theodor Debris, who illustrated and published the greater and smaller journeys to America, the West Indian journeys, as well as the East Indian journeys to Asia, in continuation of the work of his father, Theodor Debris. And as a small hint, here is the famous Hans Staden engraving, which plays such an important role for the Brazilian modernists. So the world is connected, I wanted to say. After the death of her father, Matthäus, her stepfather, the painter Jakob Marell, significantly promoted her artistic career. And to the fellows, I gave a little pencil with the motifs of Jakob Marell. So not by Maria Merian, but by Jakob Marell. Early on, she was interested in observing nature, especially the development and metamorphosis of caterpillars. The metamorphosis of insects became her great life theme. At the same time, her artistic talent made her an esteemed flower painter, like other women at the same time as well. After marrying the painter Johann Andreas Graf, she went to Nuremberg, but then returned to Frankfurt alone with her two daughters, Johanna and Dorothea, to live with her mother, who was widowed for the second time. Merian became increasingly known as a naturalist and draftswoman, especially when she published her first books. In 1675, the first three volumes of her new flower book, and in 1679, Das Raupenbuch, The Caterpillars, Wonderful Metamorphosis and Strange Flower Food. Here I have some two details so that you can see that the insects are also within the flower book. And here you can see her signature, who is closing this circle. So these circles really very often, we can find very often in her work. Presumably encouraged by her half-brother, Caspar, and perhaps also at the request of her mother, she spent 5 years with her daughters and her mother with a pietist sect, the Labadists, in Dutch Friesland at Walter Castle. During this time, she separated from her husband and took the name Merian again. Before she was Maria Graf, and now she is Merian again. The women who owned Walter Castle, the Sommelsdijk sisters, had family ties to Suriname. The brother was the governor there, and the Labadists repeatedly sent missionaries to the colony. There was even a Labadist settlement in Suriname, which Maria Sibylla will visit during her own stay in Suriname. Maria Sibylla Merian was always interested in the things and matters of nature, and all the more so in those things that arrived from far away, from the Dutch colonies, and which went en masse to the private collections that were highly fashionable at that time. After moving to Amsterdam in 1690, leaving the Pietist sect, she settled down as a freelance painter and businesswoman and succeeded in re-establishing her reputation after 5 years of retreat. She got to know many of Amsterdam's famous natural history cabinets and collections. In 1699, she put her desire into practice, sold her possessions, and traveled to Suriname with her daughter Dorothea, who apparently assisted her in everything, with the purpose of studying the tropical nature, especially plants and insects. This quite extraordinary journey by two single women at the end of the 17th century takes place within the logistics and the logics and the power structures of Dutch colonial society. Merian describes the reason for her journey as follows in her autobiographical preface to her Metamorphosis Insectorum Surinamensium. Published in 1705, after her return from Suriname. I was astonished to see what lovely creatures were brought back from the East and West Indies, but their origin and manner of reproduction were lacking, that is, how they transformed themselves from caterpillars into butterflies and so forth. All this inspired me to undertake a long and costly journey and to sail to Suriname in America. a hot and humid country from whence the aforementioned gentleman obtained these insects to pursue my observations. There are no personal documents left from this journey, no letters, no diary. After 2 years, Merian, seriously ill with malaria, was forced to return to Amsterdam. The Surinamese insect book, which she published self-financed after her return, is considered her masterpiece, even though it sold little because of the high price. Merian's fame had spread, and in the year of her death, even Tsar Peter the Great sent people to buy from her. After Merian's death, her daughter Dorothea went to St. Petersburg with her husband, the painter Georg Xell. Today, one of the most important collections of Merian originals is to be found in St. Petersburg. I would like to briefly quote a sentence by one of my authors, by Sarah Pomeroy, on this. All is connected. In January 1717, the same month that Maria Sibylla died, agents of Tsar Peter the Great of Russia purchased nearly 300 of her watercolor paintings and her study book. Peter was building a new Western-style city, St. Petersburg, named after himself. He wanted to make it, and this is a citation in the citation, a second Amsterdam. End of citation. Short as this data overview is, it catches our attention. A young girl becomes a self-taught naturalist in the second half of the 17th century. She also receives a very good drawing education. She will become a businesswoman who contributes significantly to her family's income. She decides to go to Friesland together with her mother and daughters and separates from her husband. She conducts scientific studies, especially insect research, and illustrates them, which brings her broad public and scientific recognition. Even Leibniz wanted to meet her, I have read anywhere, but Merian was no longer living in Frankfurt at this time. After 5 years with the Pietist, she began a new life as a researcher, artist, and businesswoman in Amsterdam, and ultimately went to Suriname for 2 years, where both Merian and her daughter Dorothea were regarded as highly strange beings in the dominantly male colonial plantation society. Merian lived and worked, we can say, in highly diverse social convivial configurations and different historical regimes in Germany, Holland, and Suriname. And beyond that, she was interested to understand convivial configurations in nature, practicing a proto-ecological view of life cycles, symbiosis, transformation processes, genesis, and passing in flora and fauna. My lecture, however, is not dedicated to the historical Maria Sibylla Merian. As a specialist in literature and cultural studies, I would like to ask how this amazing story of Maria Sibylla Merian is translated into today's world. What is the present day fascination that explains why our center is named after Maria Sibylla Merian? Merian was already a well-known and esteemed personality in her own time, and she was certainly an unusual figure. In the 19th century, however, she was widely disavowed as a naturalist. She was marginalized from the history of science because of supposed inaccuracies and errors and became less visible. It was not until the middle of the 20th century that she was rediscovered and perceived in a new way, for various reasons, as I will show. I come to my second point. Maria Sibylla Merian was rediscovered from different perspectives as an unusual naturalist and pioneer, as an autodidact who asserted herself as a researcher and artist, as an unusual female personality in the age of the Baroque between recognition and marginalization, as a child prodigy, as a rational businesswoman, as an artist, adventurer, world traveler, as a proto-ethnographer in dialogue with her indigenous and black servants, as she says, in fact, slaves. She became known as a survivor who defied all odds, in short, as a historical figure who challenges the researcher's gaze in every respect. And I refer here to the historical research on Maria Sibylla Merian once again, for example, by Natalie Simon Davis, Londa Schiebinger, or Claudia Swan, who has already given a lecture on Maria Sibylla at a Mesilla conference in 2017. But my aim is here to look at Merian narratives in which these questions have been taken up by writers, publicists, curators, often in a creative way, aimed at a wider audience. And in this context, I'm particularly interested in the way the Suriname episode is narrated. My corpus consists of the following six texts from different disciplines and genres. It is, of course, an incomplete selection of texts. There are many more books about her. Among them is also Natalie Simon Davis' book, because I'm interested in her deliberate use of some literary strategies. So the first book is Uta Kepler, Die Falterfrau, The Butterfly Woman, first published in 1963. Natalie Simon Davis, Women on the Margins, Three 17th Century Lives from 1995. Dieter Kühn, Frau Merian from 2002, Mrs. Merian with exclamation point. Katrin Schubert, Maria Sibylla Merian, Travel to Suriname from 2010. Barbara Beuys, Maria Sibylla Merian, artist, scientist, businesswoman from 2016. Sarah Pomeroy, Chayarani, Katiritambi, Maria Sibylla Merian, artist, scientist, adventurer, 2018. All these books deal with the art of biographical writing. And at this point, I would like to briefly recall an obvious aspect of biographical research. Biographies are always constructions, and traditionally, they often aim to establish a sort of coherent life story, which in reality cannot be derived from the contingent nature of the events of a person's life. Pierre Bourdieu once called this striving for coherence and deep access to a human life the biographical illusion. My reflections will therefore focus on how this illusion of a coherent life story is pursued in the case of Merian. The unconsciously persisting gesture of coherence in biographical writing is especially interesting with regard to Merian's stay in Suriname, because so little is known about the real circumstances, which poses a real challenge to all biographies. This is precisely what I would like to discuss in the following. First, however, I would like to briefly demonstrate this constructivist character of biographies by looking at the beginnings of these texts, the so-called incipit. First sentences play an important strategic role, not only in literary texts, but also in historiography and in many texts in the humanities, because they orient the reader to the following narrative. They are designed to catch the attention, to arouse curiosity. Please listen to these beginnings. In each case, I have attached an illustration, mostly by Merian, which I thought would be appropriate and gives us also an idea of Merian's work in its variety. So, the beginning of the biographical novel by Uta Kepler. It was gloomy in the attic. Strips of dull yellow light fell in obliquely through the skylight over trunks and scarlet upholstery. Jugs and glasses standing on the dusty table caught the rays flashing and reflected the red of the fabric. Maria Sibylla did not move. She watched the play of brightness and shadow and held her embroidery in her lap. Here, the young Maria Sibylla is just dying to be able to throw aside her traditional feminine duties in order to finally pursue her great curiosity about the things of nature. One already suspects on the first pages, great things will follow. We will read the story of a child prodigy. Here I combined it with an early flower pointing by Merian. So the next text is by Natalie Simon Davis, Women on the Margins. In June 1699, Maria Sibylla Merian and her daughter Dorothea boarded a ship in Amsterdam for America. Their destination was Suriname, where they wanted to study and paint the insects, butterflies, and plants of the tropical country. Thus, the historian introduces a very first short biographical sketch of her comprehensive Marian study, which is then devoted in detail to the life story. I have chosen to show here the image of the Flos Pavonis, described by Maria Sibylla Merian in 1705, and I would like to cite her observation here, the Flos Pavonis, a flower from Suriname. So, this Flos Pavonis, the peacock flower, is a plant measuring 9 feet tall. It bears yellow and red flowers. The seed is used by women giving birth to carry on the labor. The Indians who are not treated well when in service with the Dutch use the peacock flower to abort their children, not wanting their children to be slaves like them. The black female slaves from Guinea and Angola have to be treated very kindly. Otherwise, they do not want to have children in their state of slavery and will not have any. Indeed, they sometimes even kill them because of the harsh treatment commonly inflicted on them, because they feel that they will be reborn in a free state in their own country, as I heard from their own lips. This is a quite amazing observation in the Suriname book, and we will come back to this later. The next, for Simon Davis, for Simon Davis, this observation is really crucial, because of certain hypotheses she has. So the next example is Dieter Kühn. He says, he starts his book with, yes, this is what is popularly said about Maria Sibylla Merian. Already as a child, a girl of 13, she began to do research, first on the caterpillars of the silkworm, and early on, strikingly early on, her talent as a graphic artist became apparent, and so on. Then follows an often quoted anecdote of Maria Sibylla's grabbing of a tulip in an aristocrat's garden and her following beautiful drawing on which one could recognize the future great artist. A page and a half further on, the author, Dieter Kühn, suddenly interrupts himself and asks, is it like that? What was it like that? And will continue then to write and draw out his huge 650-page life story of Maria Sibylla Merian and her manifold complex circumstances. And I have chosen here the only historically authenticated portrait of Merian, in a sense to signal the huge biographical challenge he takes with his book. The next example is by Katrin Schubert. She starts her book, born in 1647 as the daughter of the famous engraver Matthias Merian. Maria Sibylla Merian was not only taught to engrave and color copper plates in his studio, she also learned watercolor and oil painting and the skills of publishing, so that her pictures did not remain hidden in notebooks, but were transmitted to posterity in large format folio volumes. Here, in one single sentence, the trajectory of an entire life and work and the reception appears as a great causality or even teleology. The author focuses, of course, especially on the Suriname book. This is why I have chosen as an illustration the incipit of this book, that is the first plate showing the tropical pineapple with the cockroaches, by the way. The next example is by Barbara Beuys. Her first sentence is very short. Life and death followed each other in quick succession, nothing unusual in these times. In this first sentence, the focus lies, in fact, on the family history of Maria Sibylla Merian, who grows up in a patchwork family of artists and publishers due to the death of her father Merian and her stepfather Jacob Marel. But it also points, I believe, at the many European wars in the 16th century. This is in the 17th century. This is why I chose here as an illustration the famous plate 18 from the Suriname book, which shows these life cycles in the tropical fauna. Living and dying are represented here as devouring and being devoured in a quite violent way. It is one of the most significant, most discussed, and also most controversial images of the Suriname book. And finally, this is a book by Sarah Pomeroy and Chayarani Katiri Tambi, Maria Sibylla Merian, artist, scientist, adventurer. They start, it was a dangerous voyage, 2 months crossing the Atlantic Ocean in a wooden boat about the length of 2 school buses. Storms rocked the seas and pirates plied the waters looking for ships carrying valuable cargo. This is how an adventure book begins. And indeed, the author dedicates this book to her grandchildren. The picture shows a caiman. And in choosing this picture, I wanted to point out 2 things. One, that Merian brought back to Amsterdam numerous highly desirable and very valuable things of nature, not really the things the pirates were looking for, such as a small caiman and other animals and plants preserved in alcohol. And the second point I wanted to point out is that Maria Sibylla's daughter Dorothea, who was with her in Suriname, was also an artist. All biographers are constantly consternated that Dorothea is never mentioned in Merian's Suriname book. This painting belongs to the British Museum, where the former attribution was obviously corrected. So this painting is by Dorothea Graf, her daughter, and not by Maria Sibylla Merian. I come to the third point of my lecture, a comparative focus on the 6 texts, with special emphasis on the Suriname episode. And in our interdisciplinary circle, I wanted to try to present my readings a little more schematically and not just discursively or hermeneutically. For this reason, I have created this comparative scheme. This allows us to better visualize the very different forms of biographical writing. So I will explain my scheme. This is Uta Kepler, whom you already knew from my first citations. She's a German art historian and writer of biographies. We saw it is a biographical novel, and only 7% are dedicated to the Suriname episode. So it's really a very little part of the book, and what is interesting, she writes this part on Suriname by inventing personal letters, which Maria Sibylla Merian never has written, and letters written to her second daughter and to other authorities in Amsterdam. So we learn by this invented letter how was the life in Suriname. Here I'm interested how is represented Merian's view of the conviviality in Suriname. Yeah? In this book, colonial society, the plantation society, the slaveholder society, is a mix of adventure, tropical wilderness, slavery, and encounter with the bon sauvage. And Merian speaks herself about her helpful servants, in fact, her slaves, but she never says slaves. So in this book, I think we are not astonished. Merian is an exceptional female personality. She is a child prodigy from the beginning on and has a position of an idealist, sort of also paternalistic humanist. The second book would be by Natalie Salmon Davis, A Historical Study. But it enters here because Natalie Salmon Davis uses literary strategies. She's a well-known historian. The book is not only about Maria Sibylla Merian, but also on Marie de l'Incarnation und Glickel Bas Juda Leib, and a third part about Maria Sibylla Merian. It's historiography. It includes historical writing footnotes, academic footnotes. She did archival research, and but there is a literary part in it. The Suriname episode takes 50% of this Merian chapter. And the narrative strategy to represent Suriname is a sort of experimental narrative, because she invents, reading very well the Suriname book and the observations from which we already heard this one example. Reading very well the observations by Merian, she tries to reconstruct a sort of dialogue between women, yeah, between her indigenous and black assistants, in fact slaves, yeah, which she had bought on the slave market. And Natalie Simon Davis creates here the imagined voices of, we can say, the other woman. So the view on conviviality in Suriname would be from the privileged situation of the dialogue with the black slaves and indigenous women. Yeah, Floss Pavonis was a good example for this. Simon Davis speaks about a sort of female science. She underlines very much the empathy of Merian to speak with these people, and she herself uses the empathy to write this. And in all, she constructs a sort of counter-image against the male sugar plantation society. We could even say there is a sort of female ecology which we find in this book. Yeah, but Simone Davis says also she never mentions the names of her assistants, serfs, slaves, and she does not at all mention her own daughter, who is really helping her a lot. So we could say Natalie Simone Davis proposes here a sort of concept of female conspiracy, and we could say here we could perhaps find an idea that Merian critically approached the colonial society. So the next book is by Katrin Schubert. She is a German freelance author. She studied literature, and she's a writer of travel guides and a writer of biographies. And her book has this title, Maria Sibylla Merian, Travel to Suriname, from 2010. It is a biography, but in fact, it is very much focused on the travel. She did a lot of readings, of course, but the book has no academic footnotes. It's richly illustrated, and here it has a catalog style. 80% of the book are dedicated to the Suriname travel. And also the pre-Suriname chapters already point to Suriname. The narrative strategy is a historical account, an often empathic narration of possibly lived realities in Suriname, because she wants to understand Merian's mentality and circumstances. In fact, she introduces also backup information about Suriname, about the slave society, about slavery, and illustrations in the text, and she also includes photographs of the plants, insects, and landscape. I think the author has done his own travel, her own travel to Suriname, and I could not now here check if the photographs are by herself, but I suppose it. So the view of conviviality in Suriname in this book by Merian would be focused very much on the conviviality between animals and plants, so human, non-human conviviality. It is a sort of proto-ecologist view. And sometimes Merian also appears as a critical observer of colonial society. But she does not question slavery, but at the same time, Merian's dependence on her slaves' help is emphasized, slaves' help in field trips and research. And in all, we could say Suriname, despite of all the hardship and disease, she was very, very ill with malaria. This is why she came back after 2 years to Amsterdam and survived it. Suriname is really the biographical climax towards which Merian's life is converging. So this is really the construction of a very, very strong coherence in this biography. The next book is by Barbara Boyles. This is also a very interesting book for us today, because Barbara Boyles uses very actual concepts. It's a sort of translation of contemporary discourses on knowledge production, knowledge circulation, connectedness, trans-areal relation, etc. This book seems to me really very interesting because of the use of these concepts. And interestingly, she also includes more than the other books the religious dimension, perhaps with the exception of Dieter Kuhn's book. So Barbara Beuys did a big research about the Pietist sect where Maria Sibylla spent 5 years. Her narrative, the genre is a biography without footnotes, extensive bibliography, and as I said, a special attention to the Pietist period. But Suriname only takes 4% of the whole book. This is interesting. Suriname is written, so she takes into account that there are not many informations about this period. She gives very brief factual descriptions which emphasize Marianne's scientific rationality. She includes very even episodes of vivisections and other unsentimental procedures of scientific research. She describes really, she takes it out from the Suriname book and describes it here. And I would say the Marianne view of conviviality in Suriname is marked by pragmatism of a scientist and of a businesswoman in a colonial society, pragmatic also in religious question. But Barbara Beuys also speaks about Marianne's observations when Marianne critics the planters, which are only interested in sugar, but they could cultivate also cherry trees, or they could cultivate any other type of fruits and so on. So here would be interesting the view of the businesswoman. Marianne does not question slavery, but she it is said that she respects black and indigenous people and knowledge. Here we have again this concept of knowledge transfer. So we could say perhaps Barbara Beuys presents her as a person who practices a sort of scientific universalism, and this would be perhaps for her also the reason why she doesn't mention the name of her informants. She says, I got the informations by my informants, but they don't have names because they are not considered important persons. And she even doesn't mention her daughter, perhaps also because she wants to be taken serious as a universal scientist. So this book presents Marianne and her religious, cultural, scientific, and commercial contexts and networks. We come to Sarah Pomeroy and Katiri Tambi. This is a book which appeared in 2018. It was also written on broad readings of Marianne studies. Perhaps I should say that Sarah Pomeroy is a specialist of classic history and of women's history, and she collaborated with an entomologist who presented new explanations and analysis of the plants painted by Marianne. Yeah, it is a biography. 30% are given to the part of Suriname, and the narrative strategies are factual descriptions, even when they are imagined, of living circumstances and activities in Suriname, completed with didactic information about Suriname and experts' knowledge on Marianne's illustrations. And the book is dedicated to the grandchildren of Sarah Pomeroy. This is why there is this didactic tone in it. Marianne's view of conviviality in Suriname is presented in this book as a scientist's view on nature. Pomeroy, in 2018, writing in the US, she said, Marianne was shocked, I was a shocked observer, but at the same time, a pragmatic beneficiary of colonial slaveholding society, but she recognizes and valorizes the knowledge of indigenous women informants. We have here a narration of the Suriname episode as a special one and unusual moment in Marianne's life, but within a very coherent life flow. I put this is the last book in my corpus, Dieter Kühn. I put him here on the last place because I think it is for me the most important book. He's a German writer, well known for his literary biographies, which are very special and they have a quite good reception. Not all of them, they are very experimental, and really I discovered myself a very interesting author. The title is Frau Merian, eine Lebensgeschichte, Mrs. Merian, a life story. The genre is not very clear. He says it's a history of a life story. It is a literary biography, but in fact it is much more. It is based on very, very broad researches about historical context and circumstances. It is anti-chronological, it's an anti-chronological narrative. It is very fragmented, it has a lot of interruption strategies, it is self-reflexive, meta-literary, and in all very empathic. Only, 10% are dedicated to Suriname, but Suriname is very much appears from time to time before the real Suriname period. So how is this Suriname experience represented? What are the strategies? The writer asks how to represent what is so difficult to know. We don't know anything about, or we don't know so little about the Suriname episode. And he always speaks that he has to make approximations, Annäherungen. He does it via empathy. He tries to imagine Merian. He uses analogy as a strategy, analogy in reading historical parallel texts, historical parallel concepts, or also he makes parallels of the same travel 100 years later in order to get the feeling of the ship travel. And he also includes own practices and corporal experiences like illness. He says he was picked by a tick, which is quite dangerous, because it can transmit a lot of diseases. Yeah, in Germany we have many forests where these insects are very contagious. Yeah, so he had this bite of a tick, and he said, "What was it in the case of Merian that she was bitten by a mosquito which transmitted malaria?" No? So these type of analogies are we can find quite a lot in this book. I would say he uses his writing in the way of a thick description, and I use this term really in the sense of Clifford Geertz. He loves terminologies. Special terminologies. He really practices complexity, connectedness, etc. And he gives us an intense speculation about historical realities. For example, the transatlantic slave trade, indigenous knowledge, etc. The transatlantic slave trade, this is very interesting because it's only here that I found that he speculates that Maria Sibylla Merian might have traveled to Suriname on a slave trade ship. Yeah. So what might she have seen? Yeah, these are the questions he is asking. Yeah. So Merian's view on conviviality in Suriname. He deduces a lot from parallel texts. Suriname, and he states in his book, Suriname was a tremendously brutal slaveholding society compared with the other slaveholding societies by England and France and so on. Suriname was, it seems, much more brutal. So what did Merian think? This is his question. Merian's slaves gave her information about plants, for example, the Flos pavonis. And his hypothesis is Marianne treated her slaves probably better than was customary on the plantations. And I have a citation here, which I would like to share with you. He says, "I cannot prove it, but I'm nevertheless sure she treated her slaves better than was common on the plantations. The female slave, the slaves rather, as collaborators, who also, as she herself testified, brought her local plants and insects, and who told her stories. But it must be written down in this way. Mrs. Marianne owned people. She was a slave owner in a society of slave owners." And he asks also, as the others do, or most of them, what about her daughter? Why isn't she there? Why isn't she mentioned? Yeah. We can summarize in this book of Dieter Kuhn, Marianne is only one of Kuhn's many protagonists. Many protagonists such as plants, butterflies, caterpillars, but also war, violence, collections, ships, slaves, slave owners, viruses, the author himself. Description, he gives us a thick description of a very connected universe through time, subjects, agencies, and environments. For example, he himself visits the surroundings of mines, yeah, where might have been past Marianne looking for her caterpillars. No? But always thinking about that a single woman going out of the town might have been very menaced by violence and so on. So I come to my last part, and I want to summarize these findings and draw a few conclusions. From my analysis of these different attempts to represent the Suriname episode, we can perhaps draw some interesting conclusions regarding the questions of the representation of conviviality in the colonial slaveholding system. It seems to me that the experimental modes of writing, which on the one hand follow and contribute to historical research, but on the other hand also actively address and make visible the gaps and question marks, have provided the most interesting insights. This is undoubtedly the case of the historian Natalie Simon Davis herself, who, given the poor data situation, develops a rather plausible speculation about the communication between Marianne and the subaltern woman, that is, the enslaved indigenous and black women, based on intensive textual and pictorial analysis and allowing herself empathy and a gender-sensitive gaze. In doing so, the slaveholding society, of which Marianne herself is a part, appears in a different light and allows us to think further with a critical eye on the historical circumstances of the colonial conviviality. Dieter Kuhn, for his part, postulates, among others, also clearly inspired by Simon Davis, to whom he often refers, the necessity of a very dense representation of Marianne's vita together with the broadest context of her life circumstances. This also applies to the Suriname journey in the colonial contexts of Dutch slaveholding society, as a fact, as he says, that is shameful for Marianne herself, but also for our own view on Marianne today. Here, Dieter Kuhn, going much further than Simon Davis, uses numerous literary and historiographical strategies of an experimental, auto-reflexive writing that is acutely aware of historical ignorance. The other books, by contrast, despite all their timeliness, appear relatively traditional. They show themselves well-informed, but they have no deeper doubts about representation. Not even the poorly documented Suriname episodes ultimately poses any bigger challenge. The narrative is relatively linear, not exclusively in the indicative mood, but also in the speculative conditional mood, but ultimately in such a way that a biographical coherence emerges. Mm-hmm. However, we can state that the more normal and coherent the discourse, the less tangible is the friction that underlies the nexus of conviviality and inequality. So I would therefore like to venture a speculation of my own in conclusion. I think one could, for example, build on the empathic auto-reflexive considerations and strategies by Dieter Kuhn, based on analogical and contextualizing approaches, and explore further contexts of conviviality in Suriname around 1700, which go beyond the occidental gaze. I'm thinking of the indigenous actors, their voices, their traditions, but also of the actors from the enslaved people from Africa, of whom there is a growing body of historical evidence that could be included. Basically, this could be done using the same literary strategies as Dieter Kuhn does, or partly Natalie Simon Davis does as well. In a history of Marian's life that really strives for completeness, which would not have to place in a history of Marian's life that really strives for completeness, which would not have to place Marian at the center of the story, but would tell countless other stories, it is precisely these missing voices which one would now have to integrate in an intelligent way, with all their specific social experience and with their ecological knowledge. Especially Dieter Kuhn's text seems to me to be designed for such a further opening. This is why I really would wish that this great Marian book would find an international audience. As far as I know, this book was not translated. I perfectly understand why, because it's so difficult, no? With all these terminologies he uses, but it would be really nice to translate it. So thank you very much for your attention.